Well, good morning, and welcome to our service today at St. Thomas of Becket. My name is Reverend David Matthews. I'm very glad that you're able to join us together today. Today marks another day in our season of Easter, and we're continuing on with our sermon series entitled The Story, and we've come to chapter 30 of 31. If you're new with us today, that's okay. You don't require any previous biblical knowledge to be part of this study. What we're doing is we're following the story, recognizing that there are two stories, our story and God's story. And we're seeing how these two stories fit together. And today we're looking at the life of Paul. So we begin our service today in worship and song, so let us sing together.
The Lord be with you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, he said, "As for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down." They asked him, "Teacher, when will this be? And what will be the sign that this is about to take place?" And he said, "Beware that you are not led astray. For many will come in my name and say, 'I am he,' and 'the time is near.' Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified. For these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately." Then he said to them, "Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places famines and plagues, and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance, for I will give you words and a wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name, but not a hair of your head will perish. By your endurance, you shall gain your souls." The Gospel of Christ.
A reading from the Book of Acts. When the 7 days were almost completed, the Jews from Asia, who had seen him in the temple, stirred up the whole crowd. They seized him, shouting, "Fellow Israelites, help! This is the man who is teaching everyone everywhere against our people, our law, and this place. More than that, he has actually brought Greeks into the temple and has defiled this holy place." For they had previously seen Trophimus the Ephesian with him in the city, and they supposed that Paul had brought him into the temple. Then all the city was aroused, and the people rushed together. They seized Paul and dragged him out of the temple, and immediately the doors were shut. While they were trying to kill him, word came to the tribune of the cohort that all Jerusalem was in an uproar. Immediately he took soldiers and centurions and ran down to them. When they saw the tribune and the soldiers, they stopped beating Paul. Then the tribune came, arrested him, and ordered him to be bound with two chains. He inquired who he was and what he had done. Some in the crowd shouted one thing, some another, and as he could not learn the facts because of the uproar, he ordered him to be brought into the barracks. When Paul came to the steps, the violence of the mob was so great that he had to be carried by the soldiers. The crowd that followed kept shouting, "Away with him!" The word of the Lord.
A reading from the Book of Acts. When we came into Rome, Paul was allowed to live by himself with the soldier who was guarding him. 3 days later, he called together the local leaders of the Jews. When they had assembled, he said to them, "Brothers, though I had done nothing against our people or the customs of our ancestors, yet I was arrested in Jerusalem and handed over to the Romans. When they had examined me, the Romans wanted to release me, because there was no reason for the death penalty in my case. But when the Jews objected, I was compelled to appeal to the emperor, even though I had no charge to bring against my nation. For this reason, therefore, I have asked you to see and speak with you, since it is for the sake of the hope of Israel that I am bound with this chain." They replied, "We have received no letters from Judea about you, and none of the brothers coming here has reported or spoken anything evil about you. But we would like to hear from what you would think, for with regard to this sect, we know that everywhere it is spoken against." After they had set a day to meet with him, they came to him at his lodgings in great numbers. From morning until evening, he explained the matter to them, testifying to the kingdom of God and trying to convince them about Jesus both from the law of Moses and from the prophets. Some were convinced by what he had said, while others refused to believe. So they disagreed with each other, and as they were leaving, Paul made one further statement. The Holy Spirit was right in saying to your ancestors, through the prophet Isaiah, go to this people and say, you will indeed listen, but never understand, and you will indeed look, but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and their ears are hard of hearing, and they have shut their eyes, so they might not look with their eyes and listen with their ears and understand with their heart in turn, and I would heal them. Let it be known to you, then, that this salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles. They will listen. He lived there 2 whole years at his own expense and welcomed all who came to him, proclaiming the kingdom of God and teaching about the Lord Jesus Christ with all boldness and without hindrance. The word of the Lord.
Let us pray. Gracious God, may your words be spoken and your words be heard. Bend our hearts and our minds, Lord, to hear your voice speaking to us this day. And we pray these things all in Jesus' blessed name. Amen. In our gospel message today, we hear the words of Jesus Christ talking to us about the end of the age. And he says, the nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There'll be great earthquakes, famines, pestilence in various places, and fearful events and great signs from heaven. Now that sounds like a difficult time. But he says these words also. But before all this, they will lay their hands on you and persecute you. See, many people were wondering when Jesus was going to come again, perhaps like today. And they see difficult things going on in the world. Hard times, wars, famines, pestilence, sickness. Sound familiar? And the people wanted to know, Jesus, when is the end? When are you going to return? Jesus is going to return. But he says to them, but before all this, they will lay hands on you and persecute you. See, you and I have been given a mission, a call. We are to go and to fulfill this call, to go out into all the world and share the gospel of Jesus Christ with all nations, with all people. And we are to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In our readings today, we hear of Paul's missionary journeys and them coming to an end. See, Paul had been traveling throughout Asia Minor, what is modern-day Turkey. He had been going and sharing in Ephesus and Philippi. He had gone into the nation of Greece, and he'd spoken in Athens and Corinth. And as he had gone and done all of this, and he had set up churches wherever he went, then he had a sense from the Holy Spirit that this was over. And he was to return to Jerusalem. His friends tried to encourage him, don't go. There are people there who want to kill you. Don't go. And yet Paul knew that he had to be sensitive to that spirit's leading. He knew that there were 2 stories. It was his story of his life, but that there was another story. The story of how his life intertwined with all other stories, with the story God was making, God was telling. And so he knew that he had to go. So Paul does. Paul gets in a boat and sails to Jerusalem. And when he lands in Jerusalem, he meets with the local church, and they're excited and happy to see him. But they give him a warning that there are people who have been spreading lies about him, and that these people want to hurt him. And so Paul here is encouraged to go to Jerusalem to make, to go to the temple in Jerusalem to make a sacrifice, to there help people to pay their vows to God, to fulfill their vows that they've made. And so Paul says he will. And there he goes. And when he is there, a problem happens. A crowd rises up, and they seize him. and they shout, "Men of Israel, help us. This is the man who teaches all men everywhere against our people and our law and this place. And besides, he has brought Greeks into the temple area and defiled this holy place." Well, that's not actually what's happened. Paul was never teaching against Israel. He was never teaching against the law, and he was never teaching against the prophets, and he didn't bring Greeks into the temple. See, the people had seen Paul earlier associating with Greeks, and so they thought that he had brought Greeks into the temple. He didn't. Furthermore, they had told or said that he was teaching against the law, but Paul never was. Paul was actually always teaching about what the heart of the law was. In a letter to Timothy years before, he had written this: "As I urged you when I went into Macedonia, stay there in Ephesus, so that you may command certain men not to teach false doctrines any longer, nor to devote themselves to myths and endless genealogies. These promote controversies rather than God's work, which is by faith. The goal of this command is love, which comes from a pure heart and a good conscience and a sincere faith. Some have wandered away and have turned to meaningless talk. They want to be teachers of the law, but they do not know what they're talking about or what they so confidently affirm. We know that the law is good if one uses it properly. We also know that the law is made not for the righteous, but for the lawbreakers and the rebels, the ungodly and the sinful, the unholy and the irreligious, for those who kill their fathers and mothers, for murderers, for adulterers and perverts, for slave traders, for liars and perjurers, and for whoever else is contrary to sound doctrine that conforms to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which has been entrusted to me." You see, Jesus is not contrary to the law. Rather, he is the fulfillment of it. He is what the law always pointed towards. He is what the prophets always hoped for. The Jewish people have gone through many difficult and hard times. They longed for more. They longed for the coming of God's kingdom. If those people undergoing that time saw Jesus for who he truly was, well, then they would have rejoiced in him. Paul's message and Jesus Christ himself are not contrary to the law, but they are the fulfillment of it. They are the completion of it, the hope that it always meant and desired to bring about. A person's heart and life who are fully and completely turned towards God. The presence of God here amongst us. And yet these people stirred up the trouble, the crowds, and they stirred up trouble for Paul. Why? Because just as Paul affirms in the letter to Timothy, these people want to be teachers of the law, but they don't know what the heart of the law is about. And they want to be teachers of the law because they want the glory of that role. They want themselves to be able to point out where people are going wrong. They want to be able to tell other people how to live their lives. That's not the heart of the gospel. The heart of the law, of the gospel itself, is freedom. Freedom for relationship with God, of knowing the heart of God, of how God is calling us to live, of how God is calling us to relate to him and to one another. That's why the summary of the law is this: to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. This is how God is calling us to live. It's why Paul went to Jerusalem. For although he knew there was hardship there, he knew that his walk with God wasn't over. He knew that his journey with God was to continue to bring this message, this truth, to wherever he went. And God was calling him onward. He went to Jerusalem and he shared this message there. In fact, when the people shouted and started to create a riot there because of Paul, the Roman officials came in to drag Paul out of that, and they arrested him. and they put him in chains. And while he was in chains, Paul asked them, would you flog a Roman citizen? Well, the Roman official suddenly became quite scared. For the Romans knew that in their law they weren't allowed to arrest and keep in chains and certainly not beat a Roman who hadn't stood trial and been found guilty of his crimes. And so they were afraid. And Paul saw an opportunity to use this for his advantage, to use this as a way, again, of how he could share the gospel of Jesus Christ, because that's what Paul cared about. He didn't care that he was in chains. He didn't care about his circumstance in life. He cared about this message and about this message getting out there. So here the Roman centurion is concerned, and so he keeps Paul in the barracks for Paul's own safety. Well, Paul's friends come to him by night, and they tell him that there is this plot that's been made to kill Paul. And so the centurion takes Paul out of the city and takes him to Caesarea where he'll be safe. And here Paul is given an audience with the governor and with the king. And Paul in this moment, because of this circumstance, because he was willing to continue to sit in chains, he has the opportunity to have this audience. He has the ear of these people. And so he keeps sharing this message. And Paul, after he shared this message and been in chains for 2 years, he then sees another opportunity. And see, the governor wants to receive a bribe from Paul to let him go. But Paul doesn't want to do that. He sees another opportunity, and so he appeals to the emperor, as Roman citizens were allowed to do. He wants the emperor to hear his case. Well, the governor knows that he's innocent and knows he should be set free. He just wanted a bribe. But not receiving that bribe and hearing Paul demand an audience with the emperor, he grants it and he sends Paul on to Rome. Paul, on his journey to Rome, is on a ship. And here on this journey, this ship goes up and down, and encounters these huge storms and these waves crashing over the front. And the ship is lost. And all of these people have to swim for shore. And Paul does. And there he is with the man who's supposed to be taking him safely to Rome. And here they encounter the locals, the people. And as they're making a fire, Paul is helping pick up sticks for this fire, a snake leaps out and bites Paul. And the people were all thinking, well, Paul must have done something truly heinous for this to have happened, for this bad thing in Paul's life to have happened. Clearly, God is against Paul. And yet the funny thing is, Paul's encountered many, many bad things in his life. Paul was in chains. Paul's been beaten. He's been flogged. And yet the circumstances of Paul's life never were about God's approval or disapproval of Paul's life. See, that's what the Romans thought. And that's what many in our world think, even many of the people in our pews, how what they believe in our congregations is that if something hard happens in their life, that God doesn't love them. God isn't there for them. But that's not the story. Paul underwent these trials willingly. Paul was willing to embrace these hardships. He could have said to God, God, I don't want to go down that route. I'm not willing to. I want an easy life. I want a life where I'm not embarrassed. I want a life where other people aren't laughing at me, aren't mocking me, aren't hurting me. I want an easy life. He could have tried to live that out. But if he did, then he would have been missing out on so much more. Paul was willing to walk the same road that Jesus did. He was willing to be on the same voyage that Jesus was on. And so consequently, he got to know Jesus so much better. He got to experience those same things. He got to experience and know the heart of God. You and I are on a journey too. We are on a journey with God. We are walking our own story, but we're also a part of his story. So my question to you today is, as we look at this, as we continue on and we come to the end of this large sermon series, this journey together, whose story is more important? Your story or God's story? See, God is trying to tell a story. He's creating a story that you're a part of. Your individual story is part of his larger one. It's a thread in this tapestry that he's making. And in our individual stories, when we don't want to partake, when we try and make it about ourselves, we start to tug and we start to pull at what's around us, making it about us. And in doing so, we start to damage the tapestry that God's making. See, God is good and loving. He is wonderful. And his heart is for you. His heart is for me. So the story that he's making isn't for your bad, isn't for mine, but it's actually for your best, and it's for mine. And unfortunately, sometimes in our story, we don't really interpret or understand what really is our best. So my hope and my challenge for you this day is this. I encourage you to read the last couple chapters of the book of Acts and to see what Paul went through. To hear the message of Paul's life. And to then look at your own life and your own story. And ask this question, God, where are you in this? Am I always seeking just what's easiest for me, for what's my best? And to ask God, God, how can I be part of your story? How can I seek the best for your story? God's given you a mission. God's given you a call. How we answer that call, how we answer that mission, is how we fit into God's story. Are we a beautiful thread that's bringing out the best in all that's around us? Or are we tugging and fighting and trying to make it all about us? When we tug and try and make it about us, what we're really saying is, God, I don't trust you. I don't trust your good. I don't trust that you want the best for me. God loves you. God loves you with all of his heart. He always has. He always will. When we are willing to put our side and to see from his story, from his perspective, when we're willing to do that, then we open doors and possibilities in our own lives. Paul spoke with governors. He spoke with kings. He spoke with the emperor. He had friends in countries all over the world. He traveled the world, did all of these things because he put God first. Are you willing to do the same? God hasn't forgotten you. Not today, not ever. And he never will. Don't judge your life by its peace or its prosperity. Don't judge the success of your life by what you get. Rather, turn your heart and your life to God. Let him be the measure. Let him be the guide. Because if you do that, I promise you that you will live a life that will not compare to any other. Because you'll fulfill what God has longed for you from the creation, from when he first thought of you. So God bless you today and always. May you hear his voice calling to you this day to join with him on this journey.
A crown of thorns placed on his head. He knew that he would soon be dead. He said, "Did you forget me? For Father, did you? They nailed him to a wooden cross. Soon all the world would feel the loss of Christ the King before us.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Let us pray. Merciful God, you have prepared for those who love you riches beyond imagination. Pour into our hearts such love towards you, that we, loving you above all things, may obtain your promises, which exceed all that we can desire. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Spirit of truth given to us enables us to discern the living, risen Christ. As we gather in the company of the living God, let us pray. In our cycle of prayer today, we remember the nations of the Indian Ocean Islands, Comoros, Madagascar, the Maldives, Mauritius, and the Seychelles. In the Anglican Communion around the world, we pray for the Anglican Church of Korea. Here in Canada, we pray for Linda Nichols, our primate. In the Toronto Diocese, we pray for Andrew, our diocesan bishop, Jenny, our bishop, Anne, our metropolitan, and the religious communities of the diocese, the SSJD and the OHC. At our parish here of St. Thomas of Becket, we continue to lift up the Reverend David Matthews and Carolyn Matthews, and the Reverend Michelle Stanford. In our parish family today, we pray for Lennox and Marlene Ragbeer, Kenny and Juliet Willoughby, Frank and Donna Herridge, and Carlene Simpson, and Colleen and Garen. Lord of life, we pray that the church may be alive with your risen life, refreshed and revived by the breath of your Spirit, purified and refined like gold and silver, so that we truly offer the possibility of saving love to the searching world. Empower us by your Spirit. Grow your Church of St. Thomas of Becket. You are the one true God, and we worship you. Lord of life, we pray that in all our meetings and conferences, where important decisions are made, hearts may be turned to honor what is just and true, compassionate and constructive. We pray that in all areas where there is corruption, deceit, or distrust, consciences may be sensitized, afresh to know what is right and strive towards it. You are the one true God, and we worship you. Lord of life, we pray for the streets and places of work we represent. May they be places where the truth of your being is proclaimed daily by the way we live and handle everyday situations through your leading. May our words and actions speak of your faithful love, your graciousness, and your purity. You are the one true God, and we worship you. Lord of life, we pray for all who feel out of their depth, all who are drowning in their pain, sorrow, or guilt. See them, free them, O God, and save them. Support them to a place of safety and fix their feet upon the solid rock of your love. We pray for all who have special needs in our community, remembering those who are ill. We pray for John Fraser and for Hubert and Rihanna Massey. We also remember our relatives and friends. We pray that God's gracious and healing presence may be with them. I invite you now to say aloud in the quiet of your hearts those for whom your prayers are needed. Gracious God, we lift these people up who lay heavily upon our hearts. And God, we trust them to your unfailing grace and love. Bring healing to them, Lord. Lift them up, restore them. Bring them new life, that they may know your saving grace and joy in you. We pray these things in Jesus Christ's blessed name. Amen. You are the one true God, and we worship you. Lord of life, we remember those who have died and now see you as you really are. And we commend them to your keeping forever. You are the one true God, and we worship you. Lord of life, your love for us is so great, and our love for you so small, Thank you for accepting what we are able to offer and ignite us to a blaze of love. Living God, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now gathering our prayers and praises into one, we are bold to pray as our Savior Christ has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Now go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. This concludes our worship today. However, I encourage you to continue that spirit of worship. One such way is to click like or to subscribe to this channel, to these videos. Another way is to share this video, whether it's on a platform of YouTube or Facebook, or to share the email that you received from the church today. Our worship of God never ends. We continue on sharing that message, that light that God has placed in each of us. So go forth in that same attitude, in that same light that Christ brought into the world. God bless you today and always. Amen.